you. We are excited about praising God in this place, and welcome and greetings to all those that are following on the webcast and to all the saints born again to serve God instead of self. And I know the Sabbath is our opportunity to praise God, to prove that we love Him more than anything. And our purpose in life is all about God and Jesus Christ here. So welcome, everyone. Today is about the happiest people on the earth. And happiness, oh my goodness, it's a hard thing to actually measure. And if you do know the ingredients, let's just say you knew exactly what it was, and you're trying to measure it, could you be sure that people are just smiling on the outside in public, but maybe on the inside they're not smiling? Who's genuinely happy from within? Well, the United Nations, an intergovernmental organization that was tasked to maintain international peace and security and develop friendly relationships among nations and achieve international cooperation. And the purpose would be harmonizing all the nations. Well, they've taken it upon themselves in the last few years to measure happiness in the world. Well, how does the United Nations rank happy nations? Well, this annual report ranked 156 countries across six factors of what they considered overall well-being. And the six factors include income, and they did the GDP per capita, so the income of the people, their healthy life expectancy, social support, freedom, trust, kind of the absence of corruption, and generosity. They also have populations value their lives on a scale from 0 to 10, with the worst possible life valuing your life at a 0, the best valued at a 10. Now, over the past 2 years, the world's top 10 happiest countries have remained the same. They slightly shuffle back and forth in positions, but it's primarily Finland, Norway, Denmark, Iceland, Switzerland, Netherlands, Canada, New Zealand, Sweden, and Australia. Okay? So a lot of Scandinavian countries. Outside of the top 10, of course, the U.S. came in ranked 18th, and the U.K. one behind 19th. This year, the United States fell 4 spots from last year and 5 from 2 years ago. So worldly standards of money, health, and what the experts value, America's ranked low, but it's kind of interesting that more people want to still move and travel to America than most of these other countries rank so high. But really what I want you to notice is something huge. This measure are standards for this life. There's no quantifying the value of religion in this survey, a relationship with God, with Christ, nor afterlife. And I also noticed that this report claims it's measuring the emotion called happy. I mean, they're measuring happiness, but they definitely were not ranking smiles, or emotions were not on the standards. But rather, it seemed like they were measuring standards that they decided that bring happiness. And really, I would say more, it was standards that they believed would bring the least misery to a country or to a human. I'm really not sure if they know what they're talking about or what they're doing. The best way to analyze this UN measure, in which I'm sure that the top PhDs, experts of the world, put all their minds together to measure happiness, was that it was all external. With this as a measure, only a few can arrive at such a standard. And what is more, if the world continues to support these standards as ultimate human goals, it will ultimately increase depression and increase hopelessness in the world. Well, our very own Williamson County, you would think that if they just measured this little county, that it would have high values for all six of the key variables that contribute to happiness. However, just last week, a report showed that Williamson County police officers responded to nearly 400 calls just in this county of people that were about to kill themselves. And these police, oh my goodness, having to, not knowing what's going to happen with that gun, had to tiptoe up there and get there and help talk them out of putting that down. And the ages were 8 to 89. And these police coming to talk them out of it, 400. However, 28 didn't respond to their help. And they died in 2018. It can't be money. It can't be higher standards in life. Communities free of crime. Not that that's not nice and these standards would not looked at as desirable, but how is it that we know prisoners, a Joseph Smith, a genuinely happy, just talked to him yesterday, Joe and I did, genuinely happy, and we have people, and in fact, one of our members that, you know, that's very, very sick from cancer, but totally and genuinely, I know for a fact, at peace and happy. How can you explain the joy of children living in huts without shoes and they're happy? And also, how can you explain, on the other hand, the sadness of those who are at the top of their business in the largest houses with the fastest cars, but they're empty? You could have all of this, everything, and be unhappy. So really, what is happiness and how do you get it? And we know here, this place, for a fact that one's expectations plays a major role, a huge role. I mean, the smallest of children, they have an expectation and they keep having another one, then another one, and another one, and that one's met, and that one's met, then they get another one, and get another one, and there's never an end to even a child can be unhappy because they constantly create their next expectation instead of waiting for God to give. Most of the world lives very humbly and frugally, and no doubt those that have more, they call this poverty. They've got something, so somebody that has less, they're impoverished. It's a negative term. Jesus would call it the poor, said the poor, those who live on the bare minimum will always be among you. Reports vary, but according to a 2014 report by the United Nations, almost half of the world, over 3 billion people, live on less than $2.50 a day. And globally, more than 1 out of 10 people live in extreme poverty of under $1.90 per day. At least 80% of humanity lives on less than $10 a day. 80% on less than $10 a day. 80% of the world, less than $10 a day. Nearly a billion people entered the 21st century unable to read a book or sign their names. Some 1.1 billion people in developing countries have inadequate access to water. 2.6 billion lack basic sanitation. 1.3 people live without electricity. I mean, could go on and on. You have got to bring your mind, get a hold of it, and bring it back to how most of the world lives and what they have daily. It needs to be a constant exercise in your mind, or you're going to have a struggle with denying yourself. You're going to have a struggle with feeling like a victim, with depression. You're going to have a struggle with expectations, and you're going to have a struggle overall with anything to do with salvation, with a God up there who knows better. Job understood it. I mean, everything wiped out. Everything wiped out. And he lost all of his children in one day, all of his income, everything he had, all of his, you know, savings. And what did he do when he was asked to curse God? He said, "Naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked I will depart. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. May the name of the Lord be praised." Maybe sound strike to you, you know, as a lot of times it's read, "The Lord gave, and the Lord's taken away. May the name of the Lord be praised." I mean, that has very, very deep, deep meaning. You can't take anything with you. Paul wrote something that was beyond profound right in behind that. He says in 1 Timothy 6, "But godliness with contentment is great gain. For we brought nothing into the world, and we can take nothing out of it. But if we have food and clothing, we will be content with that." People who want to get rich fall into temptation and a trap, into many foolish and harmful desires that plunge men into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. Some people eager for money have wandered from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs. You know, you've got to ask yourself, are you eager for money? Are you eager for money? When you have many griefs, you just have griefs and then you have more griefs. You can't seem to get out of just grieving, like being upset about this and being upset about that. That's a sign that you love money. When you're not content with what you have, you'll not be content with more. The practice of self-denial, pushing back constantly, getting rid of stuff, pushing back from the food, pushing back from money, giving money away. I mean, all of this, getting it away from yourself, pushing back from the table. If you consider yourself a victim at the poverty level, you're going to continue to consider yourself a victim all your life. This attitude will never leave you, and this attitude, I will guarantee you, will never enter heaven. And I know that I've had a lot of faults to work on, but that somehow this was not one of. And I'd only tell you this not to brag, because I know it's a gift, and I only tell you this so that I can tell you what it feels like. I want to tell you what that feels like, because I've had some really times of great debt, but all through life, I was thrilled with what I had. With each living situation, no matter what it was, I was thrilled, and I never expected more. I wasn't anticipating more. I didn't covet like what others had. That didn't occur to me as a possibility. When things were so tight, I really only prayed for just enough money to pay the bills and then buy the groceries. And that was it. Vacations were not even a consideration. I can tell you, I really can't tell you how I got there, but I do credit my mother for not spoiling us. You've got to get out of the victim mode. The Apostle Paul, he said that very few people with money were even called into Christianity. So there's got to be some connection there. That's a good thing. And God knows how near we have to be dependent on Him. That's the goal. And that's what it did to me. I wouldn't trade being in debt for anything. You couldn't get me to trade that out of my life. That's how beautiful it was. That's what I did with it. Whereas the person in love with money, they just go from grief to grief. God is warning everybody to do everything without complaining. Wow. Do everything without complaining, without arguing, so that they become blameless. Of course, James adds to this. It says, what causes fights and quarrels among you? Don't they come from your desires that battle within you? You want something, but you don't get it. You kill and covet, but you cannot have what you want. You quarrel and you fight. You do not have because you do not ask. You don't ask God. You're trying to get it on your own. Build your own empire. Make your own money. You're not really asking God about it. But when you do ask, you do not receive because you ask with wrong motives, that you may spend what you get on your pleasures. You're asking for that to create your own pleasure. You're missing the point. God likes to give. You're robbing him of that opportunity. Forbes magazine had an article on how to identify if you have the wrong mindset toward money. It's a secular magazine, but it was surprisingly insightful. I thought, So the article points out that that you're going to have thoughts like this. I work so hard and I can't ever make ends meet. I'll never be able to afford a vacation. I'll take what I can get for this project, even if it's not my full rate. Why do I constantly have to struggle? It's the story of my life. There's always just enough. That's it. That's my limit. I'll never have more money than just barely enough money. It went on to say, do you view those who are more prosperous than you as greedy? Well, then you're the one that's probably greedy. Do you experience negative emotions such as jealousy or resentment when you have the occasion to experience others' wealth? So, well, good for Forbes for paraphrasing the Bible, but this is a spiritual battle. This is a fight that's going on inside of you. And, you know, God is looking. It is up to you to prove to God that money is not your purpose, your love. Is it possible that it's all a test? You don't have because the money you asked for, perhaps for yourself, is not there because you're going to take it to build and glorify God. And what has been hidden will be brought to light. Note, sometimes God reveals it through your children, and then the children wind up valuing what you're treasuring. And then you'll start seeing them turn secular. Hopefully, we correct. We pay attention and we correct this godless mindset. Unfortunately, God might have to take things away from you or whatever to get you humble. I mean, reading Hebrews is always just incredibly helpful to reprogram your mind. He says in chapter 10, remember those earlier days after you had received the light, when you stood your ground in the great contest in the face of suffering. Sometimes you were publicly exposed to insult and persecution, and other times you stood side by side with those who were so treated. You sympathized with those in prison and joyfully accepted the confiscation of your property because you knew that you yourselves had better and lasting possessions. So do not throw away your confidence. It will be richly rewarded. You need to persevere so that when you have done the will of God, you will receive what He promised. For in just a very little while, He who is coming will come and will not delay. Jesus is coming back. This is real. Do you believe? Do you believe this? Do you believe there's an afterlife? Apparently not, if you're not investing in the afterlife. This passage is so far off the charts from a spoiled child or from an adult. Nothing's worse than an adult being spoiled, being a victim or complaining or being jealous. Jealous of people even that God has given money to. Paul is making an incredible argument here to remember, to maintain. It's not just get it. It's to maintain it at all times, a mindset of no expectations. Except to expect testing, good old suffering, good old denial, suffering, surrender. Expect that. Anticipate it. Get your body ready for it. Like Paul said, I buffet my body. Get it ready for no, for a no, and for less. To have that mindset like the early Christians. Look what he's saying. Remember the early days when you received the light and you stood your ground in the great contest in the face of suffering? Wow. Now, how do you do this again? It's up here. Meditation, reminding themselves of better and lasting possessions. And in fact, it was beyond meditation, reminding each other, because it says in here, they knew. They didn't just get reminded. They knew they had better and lasting possessions. They knew it. What does that mean? I mean, do you know it? Do you own it? Do you know it? They did it because they knew it. There's such a need for our minds to take the time to pursue God to the point of knowing, not just knowing, but putting more value in the rewards in heaven versus earthly, whatever stuff. That takes prayer. That takes meditation. Jesus prayed so much. The purpose behind prayer, meditation, why do you do it? Is to own it, to know that truth. that truth, Christ, to know God, and what's the result of this? I'm telling you, the result, oh my word. The most magical thing, you know, you can put ingredients in a cake and put in flour, you put in sugar, put in, you know, a fat, and you put in some, you know, vanilla, and you stir it all around, and you have a cake. But when you put together this stuff and what I'm talking about, guess what happens to your life? You love. That's what's happening. The opposite of this war would be to say that this meditation, it eliminates delusional lies, selfishness, greed, hate. See, it eliminates the hate. It eliminates the greed. The Bible calls greed idolatry. And I get it. I think I get it. You know, sometimes you have those moments where you just feel like, I think I get it. If you pray for truth, read the truth, the words written by the prophets, the apostles, those that are enlightened, find the truth that sets you free. It eliminates the lies, the great delusion that you're a victim, that you have it too hard, others have it better. And then you don't have it too hard. You have it great. And meditation to the world, you got your Buddhist, you got your Eastern religions, you got yoga, that is so popular right now. What is going through their mind? I don't know. I don't think I want to know what they're doing, because they just let you, they don't tell you where to go, so to speak. Meditation, the world's random, and it's kind of self-focused. But to the true saint, to these Christians, what is it saying? Prayer and meditations is to focus on God. What does that mean? Really? Needs of others. What does that mean? You know, greed is ended, and selflessness, and therefore joy, is obtained. There's the ingredient. Throw all those ingredients in the cake. What we're throwing together here is the ingredients that brings this joy and then this incredible love. How? You focus on God's will. It's not just focus on God. Focus on God's will. And then the needs of others would be needs. You're learning to focus on needs. And then you see God's needs. You love others. Guess what you're going to have at the end of your life? You're going to have an abundance of saints, friends, love. It eliminates hatred from around you. And your mind goes outward, the needs of others. There's no thought of self. God may give to you, but you didn't pursue it. You may have, but you didn't grab. Things mean less and less, but what is it that makes you happy? That God is happy. And that, Remnant Nation, is an endless joy. And that gives true love. And that you have all the way inside of you. And love and joy It's like a bubble, because it's going to float right up to heaven. Hatred, jealousy, all this grief, always upset about what you have, is very heavy, and it goes below. One floats up, one crashes down. Again, notice that the world measures the superficial. They're measuring the outside circumstances. They leave out the value of God, Christ, the afterlife. But we know that happiness is from a spiritual perspective that comes from having the approval and the love of God. It's not just a smile or a GDP or life expectancy, but rather it is peace with God. And God will usually translate this peace and love with Him into peace and love with mankind. Okay, so imagine having everything in life. You're an old man now with riches, success, everything external. I mean, you got everything that the world rates as high, but no one is wanting to be around you. No one loving you. That's the result of not doing these things. And to back this up, then I want you to read about what the prisoner, when Paul was a prisoner a lot of these years of these writings, okay? So in Ephesians, I'm not going to read the whole thing, but I want to point out in verse 3, praise be to the God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us. Look at him. He is praising God, who's blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ, for he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love, he predestined us to be adopted as his sons through Jesus Christ in accordance with his pleasure and will, to the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely given us in the one he loves. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, according with the riches of God's grace that he lavished on us with all wisdom and understanding, and he made known to us the mystery of his will according to his good pleasure when he purposed in Christ to be put into effect when the times have reached their fulfillment, to bring all things in heaven and earth together under one head, even Christ. In him we were also chosen, having been predestined according to the plan in him who works out everything in conformity with the purpose of his will, in order that we who were the first to hope in Christ might be for the praise of his glory. And you were also included in Christ when you heard the word of the truth, the gospel of your salvation. Having believed, you were marked with him with the seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is a deposit guarantee and our inheritance to the redemption of those who are God's possession, to the praise of his glory. Look at the praises, to the praise of his glory. It's such a common term. We got the kids all saying it. You look beautiful. Praise God. I don't know if they're what they know what they're saying. It's become so common to the point it means nothing. But think with me. This is the secret. If this is read correctly, it's the key. If you really mean it, if you really mean it, not just praise God, it's all over our text, praise God, PG. Notice the direction of the happiness. One goes to self and one goes to God. And when you are happy for God, again, there is no end to the joy you can muster up and have. And people who love God so much, love his saints so much, like Paul, in Acts 20, when they are together and they look at the love they have for each other because of the love of God. It says in Acts 20:32, now commit you to God and to the word of his grace, which can build you up and give you an inheritance among all those who are sanctified. I have not coveted anyone's silver or gold or clothing. You yourselves know that these hands of mine have supplied my own needs and the needs of my companions. In everything I did, I showed you that by this kind of hard work, we must help the weak, remembering the words of the Lord Jesus himself, it's more blessed to give than to receive. When he had said this, he knelt down with all of them and prayed. They all wept as they embraced him and kissed him. What grieved them most was his statement that they would never see his face again, and they accompanied him to the ship. But look at the, they embraced him, they all wept. I mean, do you love each other that much? If you don't, then you don't have this love. You don't have this love if you're not loving your brother. But when you are rejoicing for God's kingdom advancing, that's what's exciting. God's kingdom is advancing, then you are excited then about the saints living for the crown of life, knowing it's going to be great in heaven. What we have before us is incomprehensible. If this is what your joy is about, if this is what gets you happy, if this is what gets you excited, we've got it. We have found it. And it is almost beyond imagination how much endless joy all of this is. This is a wonder to behold. They were all weeping out of love for Paul, because Paul loved God and they loved God, so they could all have that love. And that is the richness. Rich is love for all the saints, true love. There can't be a possibility of jealousy in that, because what they have is not what you want. If you are jealous, this is what you want. You want fame or money or praise of man or something. You're not living right. But this other, when you read Ephesians and you've read it before and it's kind of dry, praise be to the glory of God. And it's inconceivable, but we must conceive it. We must stop, close our eyes to this world, open them to the world beyond, to the city of God, the face of God, the face of Christ. What about all the amazing sacrificial saints that have gone before us? Have you ever tried to imagine meeting them and being there with them, and they're all so happy? When as a child, with the religion that I had, I couldn't even understand heaven. Now I see it's literally would be like maybe everybody's interest was this sport, and that's maybe the closest thing to worship we can see, because huge stadiums of people that are all excited about the sport, except that they compete against each other, so some are happy and some are sad. It's kind of like a bad setup every week for them. So they don't have really one goal. It's a divided goal. But that's the closest thing I can think of, is like everybody's so excited and you finally get into a room. You can't find anybody to talk about football. You can't find anybody. Nobody's interested. Nobody's interested. Nobody interested. And you finally find these fanatics about football, and you could get into the stadium and cheer and paint your face and yay and pom-poms and whatever and high fives, and how exciting. Well, if we have the same goal, it's a sight to behold. Heaven, oh my goodness. So you've got to ask yourself again, what makes you happy? Only having a satisfying, loving relationship with God and fellow saints, that's got to be it. Romans 8, what should we say then in response to this? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for all of us, how how will it be not also along with him graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who is he that condemns? Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who has raised to life at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Who shall separate? Now listen to this. Nothing external here. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine, nakedness, danger, a sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I'm convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Isn't that amazing? It is not the surroundings. It is all in the heart. It's all in the mind. These, you know, people that are in love with food will complain about how little they have to eat. Those in love with money will complain about how little they have to live on. They'll never find the happiness. So get a new heart, not a new circumstance. For godliness with contentment, what Paul say, is great gain. There's your gain that you're looking for. It's not in the stock market. It's not in the world. It's not valuing your own life on a scale of 1 to 10. It is valuing God in our lives. Valuing that on a scale from 1 to 10 with hope of the hereafter, a choice. We value God and his kingdom. And that is why we see saintly prisoners like Joseph Smith that are so joyful. And that is why those who are poor and sick can be cheerful. These saints are so happy just hearing that saints are praying for them. No expectations with our greed in check. Our focus of love is on God and the hereafter. Now, if you measure that, you would not find the happy people on a few small nations, but rather in the kingdom of love all around the world in all walks of life. And somehow I get it. Praise God. And nothing then can stop us from the love of God.